Everybody say
Easter. Could have been dead, Lord, and sleeping in our grave.
But thank God for being so good to us. Then, Lord, we pray that you bless this service. Remember the one that was sick and shut in. The one that's fortunate, the one that's office, sick and afflicted. Bless them right now in the name of Jesus. We don't have to send you nowhere because you're already there. Have mercy right now.
Have mercy.
Bless this church. Bless each and every member. Bless when we come in and going out, name by name, one by one. Bless the one that's on the way, my Father. Have mercy right now.
Have mercy.
Bless our pastor. Touch him right now in the name of Jesus. Call him in the hollow of your hand. Let him down in your mighty storehouse in the name of Jesus. Bless his home and bless his family in the name of Jesus. Dear my Father, when this life journey is over, oh Lord, we can't pray no more. We can't sing no more. And we too must go into our room and never come out again. Oh, we pray that you receive our soul a resting place somewhere in thy holy kingdom. These and those blessings. We ask that thy Son in Jesus' name we pray. And the church said amen.
Thank you.
this song says, because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Sing the song, How Great Is Our God? He's just that great. My, my, my. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
When it sits on you like that, all you can do is speak the word. At this time, we're going to move forward as best as possible. Now I have our announcements. Amen. 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 Thank God for those announcements. Thanks to God, please govern ourselves to the announcement. We may be in prayer for all the saints, those that names that were called, also their family. Amen, somebody. Y'all the quantum, amen, somebody. It's not ill to win. You go through. I think that was a little one that just yelled out, amen. God be the glory. This time we're going to have our youth come before us for our Easter presentation. The resurrection story through scripture and song. Amen. We have Go Tell It on the Mountain. We also have Jesus, Easter. We have Ari, we have Egypt, Gloria, and Hayden, and AJ. We also have a skit with Ty, Keyshawn, Taisha, and Tabar. We have a basket of Peter Cottontail. Amen. We have our scriptures by Dylan and Dallas. And then we will have another song, Jesus Paid It All. That's love. Amen. Would you please put your hands together for our people?
Good morning, Mount Nebo.
Morning.
Good morning, Mount Nebo.
Morning.
This morning, on behalf of the Sunday School, we come to you with the Easter presentation, the resurrection story through scripture and song. And how could you not tell the story about our Christ dying on the cross without first telling about our risen Savior who was born? Amen. So we're going to have our senior saints come and celebrate this morning with Go Tell It on the Mountain. So join in with them as they come before you. Amen.
So
What y'all say? What y'all want to come to church and be like, be in the clip?
Yeah, that sounds good.
All right, look, if y'all come, make sure y'all bring your family, friends, the dog, everybody.
Easter. Easter means the celebration of Easter, which was at the beginning of spring. We hide eggs on Easter because many associate them with spring and new life. Early Christians adopted these beliefs, making the egg a symbol of the resurrection and the empty shell a symbol for Jesus' tomb. This is the same as our symbol of taking communion on the first Sunday as we observe his dying on the cross for us. Now, how many of you remember this little song? And as it plays for about 4 or 5 seconds, I want you to vision our little one who couldn't make it, who would have been coming down the aisle with her little basket. Amen. And now, as we go into scripture.
Jesus loves us. John 3:16 says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life."
John 14:4 says, "And with I go, ye know, and the way ye know." John 14:5 says, "Thomas saying unto him, Lord, we know not whether thou goest, and how we know the way." John 14:6 says, "Jesus saying unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no man shall cometh unto the Father but by me."
Child of weakness, watch and pray. Bind in me thine all and all. Jesus paid it all.
Need me. walks with me. He talks with me.
Symbolizing victory over sin, crying Hosanna, blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Then Monday, Thursday, the Last Supper. This marks the Last Supper Jesus shares with his disciples. Jesus washed the feet of his disciples as an act of his service and humility. John 13:1-20. Good Friday, the trial of Jesus, his sentence of death, torture, and his crucifixion and burial. It's called Good Friday in the sense of the word good, meaning holy. Yet it is a somber day. But today is Resurrection Sunday. Today is Resurrection Sunday. Today is Resurrection Sunday. Today is Resurrection Sunday. To God be the glory.
We gotta fight. There is no greater love. praise. That's love. In spite of how you've been treated in the past, there's no question about the love of God. Because as we've often said, love is an action word. I don't know how you can top somebody dying for you. Come on, y'all ain't saying nothing in here. Somebody suffering in your place. Person who was innocent, but yet died for a sinner like you and me. That's love, y'all. Y'all were too slow on that this morning. If there is ever a time that the church ought not be silent, it's on Easter. And if you don't like the term Easter, Resurrection Sunday, and at the birth of Christ, because those are the two bookends that made the way for your salvation. And if we ought not be silent of those two crucial moments, he willingly laid down his life for us all. That's love. Father God, we thank you today. We give you honor, glory, and praise. What is you, O God, that has made us and not we ourselves? We are your people. We're the sheep of your pasture. Enter into your gates with thanksgiving. We come into your courts with praise. Come, O God, to be thankful unto you and to bless your holy and righteous name. God, we're so grateful this morning that you allowed us to bear witness of the resurrection power of Jesus Christ. Those who were without hope now have hope because of resurrection. Those who were lost in sin now have an eternal Savior because of the resurrection. Thank you, God. Those who were ostracized now have a friend that sticketh closer than any brother. God, we say thank you today. We give you all the honor, the glory, and the praise. May we never forget why you died for us. May we never forget how you died for us. May we never forget who you died for. God, we thank you today. We give you glory. Most of all, Master, we give you praise. It's in the name, the only name that matters. The name that sits above every name. For it's at the name of Jesus that every knee shall bow and every tongue must confess that he is Lord. We bow in that name today. We say, God, have your way in me and in this place. For you are the potter and we are the clay. This we ask and pray in Jesus' name. And those that love the Lord said amen.
Amen.
Come on, say amen again.
Amen.
Come on, one more time for the Holy Ghost. Amen, amen, amen. Luke 23. Thank you, Reverend Davis, reading this passage for us, and certainly to all that has transpired up until this present time. Come on, let's celebrate all of those who are children, our music team. Amen. Come on, let's celebrate yourself today. Amen. Amen. We are here by goodness and the grace of God. And it was about the sixth hour there was darkness all over the earth till the ninth hour. And the sun was darkened and the veil of the temple was rent in the midst. When Jesus had cried with a loud voice, he said, Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit. And having said thus, he gave up the ghost. I want to talk about death brought us together. You may be seated in the house this morning. Death brought us together. Death brought us together. January of 1982, an Air Force aircraft taking off from Washington, D.C. on a cold, snowy day, crashed into a bridge and plunged into the Potomac River. Television reporters with their camera crews arrived and began to cover the tragedy. They broadcast an event on live television that few who witnessed would never forget. By the time rescue efforts could be organized, the plane had virtually disappeared beneath the surface of the Potomac. Most of the passengers either had been killed already or were trapped in the wreckage beneath the water. At the surface of the water, a handful of survivors were in immediate danger of freezing or drowning. It was clear that both the location of the crash and the bitter winter weather were going to make rescue efforts difficult. Soon a helicopter flew above the survivors bobbing in the icy water. Helicopter crew dropped the flotation device on the tether. Those in the water were either too weak or confused to be lifted into the helicopter. So they were dragged to shore where they were met by medics and others involved in the rescue operation. As millions watched it on live television, a true hero emerged. Whenever the helicopter returned to the survivors and the flotation device was lowered, a man in the water would gather in the device, hand it to another survivor, and help him or her attach it properly. Finally, the only person left in the water was the man himself, who had been so willing to make sure that everyone else was rescued. But when the helicopter returned to get him, he had slipped beneath the surface of the water. This man had died saving the lives of other people. That's the sermon right there. If you heard the last part of what I just said, you should have already been in hysteria, because that's what Jesus did. This man died saving the lives of other people. Jesus' mission was coming to a climatic ending. He had celebrated the Passover with the disciples. He had washed their feet to illustrate the path of greatness in the kingdom of God. He had agonized in the Garden of Gethsemane, pondering the awful weight of man's eternal destiny. He had suffered the humiliation of an illegal trial all night long. He had been mocked and spit on. crown of thorns had been pressed into his head. He had struggled beneath the weight of the cross until a man by the name of Simon was summoned into duty to carry his cross to the place of his execution. As these events unfolded, Jesus' enemies must have been rejoicing. Finally, they thought they would be rid of the man who had become a political and religious thorn in their side. Contrast, those who had been followers of Jesus were now following at a distance, viewing this ungodly scene and wondering if God would intervene. They did not realize that what was about to transpire just outside of Jerusalem was in fact God's intervention. Jesus was simply fulfilling the plan of his Father by giving himself to die for the sins of the world. The world has never seen such a compelling demonstration of love. Just as the choir just said, that's love. It's not often that we speak of death in the sense of uniting. Death is most often thought of as a great separator or equalizer. But death has a way of bringing people together. Can I get a witness here? Once estranged family members can be reunited by death. Those who were once considered enemies can now be reunited in harmonious love by death. Paul writes in Ephesians chapter 2, verses 16 through 18, the Message Bible translation says, Christ brought us together. Christ brought us together through his death on the cross. Cross got us to embrace, and that was the end of the hostility. Christ came, preached peace to you outsiders and peace to us insiders. Treated us as equals and so made us equal. Through him we will both share the same spirit and have equal access to the Father. Every now and then, beloved, amid the frequent rudeness, conflict of our present day society, we notice the decline in the hatred, the noise coming from the media and politics. For a while at least, sounds of enmity shrink and people are they're a little bit nicer to each other. Ironically, these temporary breaks occur during times of major tragedies. Think about it for a moment. Hurricanes. We don't worry about whether you're a Democrat or Republican when tragedy strikes. Come on in here this morning. When earthquakes hit, we don't worry about whether you're white or black, Jew or Gentile. When wildfires ravage land and destroy houses, no matter if we never spoke, friend, can you grab a water hose and help me save my home? Flooding have left tremendous devastation and human suffering in their wake and will no doubt do so in the future. In addition to natural catastrophes, we have experienced significant tragedies which were entirely planned and carried out by humans. Think about a sadly mass school shootings, assassinations and terrorist attacks always attack and affect us at the very core of our being. You can't watch and listen to what's going on in Nashville and other areas and not feel a sense of hurt your own self. No, maybe it wasn't your time, but you have something that triggers and registers with you. What if it was my time? Your heart, my heart, goes out. I don't know, but my heart goes out because there's a sense of humanity and commonality between us. Doesn't matter the color of the skin at that moment. Because tragedy erases all ethnic boundaries. Y'all ain't gonna talk to me today. Tragedy erases all economic status. Doesn't matter whether you're rich or poor at that moment. Tragedy, that's what the songwriter said. Tragedies are commonplace. All kinds of diseases, people are slipping away. We witness the inflicted physical results, heartbreaking human suffering. We are in awe. Natural human impulses of compassion and commonality arise and strengthen. People of different ethnic groups, races, ages, and socioeconomic levels feel a tug within their inner being, a sense of implicit kingship. Even as mere spectators, we feel almost as if we were there sharing the pain of the most intimately affected. Beloved, this morning I want us to take a look together at this text and witness a great miracle that could only be accomplished by the loving hands of an omnipotent God. Sin in the garden created separation between divinity and humanity. But it was the death of a lamb that brought us back together. Can I get a witness in here? Sin brought pain, but death brought grace and mercy. Sin brought disappointment, but death brought about reappointment. Can I get a witness here? In fact, Paul says in 2 Corinthians 5:17, wherefore, if any man is in Christ, he is a new creature. All things are passed away. Behold, all things have become new. I used to be an outsider, now I'm on the inside. Because death brought us together. Everything changed, my Nebo, at 12 noon. Suddenly everything went dark. Sun, S-U-N, disappeared. Darkness settled over the land. It lasted for 3 hours. At 3 p.m., the sun came out just as suddenly as it had disappeared. All eyes were drawn to the center cross. There were 2 other crosses, but everybody was looking at the man in the middle. Y'all gonna help me talk about it today? Something had happened to Jesus during those 3 crucial hours. The other 2 men's faces revealed what was about to happen as they waited their impending crucifixion. But Jesus was different. Something awful had happened to him during that 3 hours of darkness. Some awful burden that had been descended on him and drained out what little life was left in him. You didn't have to be an expert to know that he was about to die. The moment has to. Jesus only has seconds to live. And all that he came to do has been accomplished. It's time to die. 2 things happen at the very end of his life that merits our attention. One, his physical suffering had reached its climax. Pain now is unbearable. Breathing is next to impossible. The crowd gathers around like scavengers circling their prey. Friends of Jesus watched in horror as his life slowly slips away. Death rattles in his throat. The angels now must look away because the Son of God is about to die. What was it like to die by crucifixion? Some years ago, two doctors on the staff of the Mayo Clinic recruited the help of a Methodist pastor to answer that question. Their research was published in the most respected medical journal in America. Journal of the American Medical Association, March 21, 1986. The article was entitled On the Physical Death of Jesus Christ. One survey, ancient literature on the subject of crucifixion along with the best modern historical research. They begin by describing the Roman practice of flogging. As the Roman soldiers repeatedly struck the victim's back with full force, the iron balls would cause deep contusions, and the leather thongs and sheep bones would cut into the skin and subcutaneous tissues. Then, as the flogging continued, the lacerations would tear into the underlying skeletal muscles and produce quivering ribbons of bleeding flesh. That love. Then they describe the results of scourging. The severe scourging, with its intense pain and appreciable blood loss, most probably left Jesus in a pre-shocking state. Physical and the mental abuse meted out by the Jews and the Romans, as well as the lack of food, water, and sleep, also contributed to his generally weakened state. Therefore, even before the actual crucifixion, Jesus' physical condition was at least serious and possibly critical. Authors then give a detailed description of various crucifixion practices. They noted that the crossbar Jesus was compelled to carry weighed somewhere between 75 and 125 pounds. Iron spikes, y'all ain't gonna help me today, approximately 5 and 7 inches long, were driven into his wrists and his feet just above the toe. Criminals were normally crucified naked, less forbidden by local custom. Once crucified, the victim was exposed to the elements, including insects would come and burrow into the open wounds or their eyes, noses, and ears. Because of the scourging, victims became a virtual open sore. When the victims were thrown to the ground on their back in preparation of transfixion of his hands, his scourging wounds was most likely would be torn open again and contaminated with dirt. I want you to really get a glimpse of what happened on the cross. Because this modern presentation of what Jesus went through does not tell the true story. It's more than he just hung on the cross. You got to examine what happened to him on the cross for you to get an appreciation of what it means when we say, Jesus loved me, this I know, for the Bible tells me. little ones to him belong. They are weak. Come on in here this morning. But he is strong. Yes! Jesus loves me. Furthermore, with each respiration, painful scourging wound would be scraped against the rough wood of the steeps. As a result, blood loss from the back probably would continue through the whole entire crucifixion ordeal. But the worst was yet to come. Once the cross was raised, breathing became progressively more difficult until finally it would become impossible. Major pathophysiological effect of crucifixion beyond the excruciating pain was a marked interference with normal respiration, particularly exhalation, weight of the body, pulling down on the outstretched arms and shoulders. 10 to fix the intercostal muscles in an inhalation state and thereby hinder passive exhalation. Some of us have breathing problems just walking from here to the car. Come on in here. Can you imagine having all of this being done to you? Adequate exhalation required lifting the body by pushing up on the feet, by flexing the elbows and abducting the shoulders. However, this maneuver would place, watch this, the entire weight of the body on the torsos and would produce searing pain. Furthermore, the flexion of the elbows would cause rotation of the wrist about the iron nails and cause fiery pain along the damaged medial nerve. Lifting of the body also painfully scrape the scourged back against the wooden steep. The authors then summarize biblical material in a remarkable, concise manner. The soldiers and the civilian crowd taunted Jesus. It's one thing to die a horrible death, but to have your enemies mocking you while you're dying for them too. That's the essence. Come on in here. You should have been here on Friday night. You'd have heard the seven last sayings. The first one is, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they are doing. In their mind, they are winning the battle. But in reality, they forgot what he said. And if I be lifted up. Can I help somebody this morning? Sometimes your enemies think they get the best of you. But in reality, they helping you, baby. Yeah, they meant it for evil. But my God and your Savior has a way of turning that thing for your good. Spoke 7 times from the cross. Since speech occurs during exhalation, these short, terse utterances must have been particularly difficult and painful.
I don't want us to get the story mixed up.
Those 7 last sayings are significant because at the time and what he was going through, he had the wherewithal to leave a lasting impression on her. About 3 p.m. that Friday, Jesus Christ cried out in a loud voice, bowed his head, and I. Roman soldiers and onlookers recognized his moment of death. Let me just help somebody now. Because he also said, no man taketh my life, but I voluntarily lay it down. And if I lay it down, I'm going to pick it up again. Can I get a witness in here? Yeah, Jesus voluntarily gave up his life. This may seem at odds with the shocking account that I just gave you. Christ was arrested. Tried like a common criminal. He was beaten within an inch of his life. Suffered the terrible ordeal of crucifixion and dying an agonizing death. All the fears that troubles the heart of man, perhaps none is greater than the fear of death. All of our fears can be rolled up into the great fear we are afraid to die. That's right. We fear death because it is final. There are no do-overs with death. We fear death because we are not sure, most of us are not sure of what happens when we die. We fear death because it means leaving the world we know for a world we know nothing about. Can I get a witness in here? Death is the final enemy. It is the end of one thing and the beginning of what? Humanity does not know how to finish that sentence. Therefore, we are afraid to die. But in our world, steps Jesus, wonderful and magnificent Savior. He boldly proclaims in John 16:33, I have said these things to you, that in me you may have peace. In the world you will have tribulations, but take heart. Why, Jesus? Because I have overcome the world. Can I get a witness in here? Death of Jesus Christ has spoiled Satan's power. Long as men stayed dead, death was Satan's ultimate tool to keep men bound in chains. But one man changed all of that. He died, but he didn't stay dead. Jesus has broken Satan's power over death. God and man are separated by sin. Man is incapable of bridging this enormous gap by himself. But God, in his infinite mercy and grace, sent his only begotten Son to do for us what we could never do for ourselves. What happened on Calvary over 2,000 years ago still touching lives this very day. How do you know that? Because Romans 5:8 said, but God demonstrates his own love toward us in that while we were still sinners, Christ, can I get a help in here, died for us. Death brought us together. Understand that Jesus could have come down. The story has no power if there was no possibility of his coming down. But he had more than enough power to come down. How do you know it? Well, if he could raise Lazarus up from the grave, he had enough power to come down off of the cross.
If he could feed 5,000 people with two fish and five barley loaves of bread, he had enough power to come down off of the cross. And if God, who was watching in heaven, also had power to intervene at any moment and rescue his son from the instrument of torture and death, he could have sent 10,000 angels to come down and fight on his behalf. He could have shaken the earth as he did for Paul and Silas. Ain't got no helping here. The point is that Jesus could have come down off of the cross. The gospel is that he would not come down because he willingly gave his life for you and me. And so when he died out there on Calvary, he was dying for you and me. When he shed his blood on the cross, he was washing away my sins. When he sacrificed his life, it was so that you and I could have eternal life. There are no ills in my relationship with Jesus Christ. He is my rock, the God Almighty. In a weary land, he is my shelter. In the time of a storm, he is my deliverer. He is my help in ages past, and my hope for years to come. My shelter from the stormy blast, and my eternal home. Yes, he died, but
together. There was enmity between humanity and God. But the Bible tells us, but God did something for us that we were not capable. Not only not capable, but not qualified. Yes. Because the qualification was, it had to be a lamb without spot or wrinkle. And the very day that you and I were born, we were born in the sin. You got to understand what that means. That doesn't mean that your mom and daddy were doing something wrong when they made you. I let you fill in the blank. But that means that when Adam and Eve sinned in the garden, the bloodline of humanity was tainted with sin. That's why even when you don't want to do wrong, you find yourself doing wrong. Come on in here this morning. I know you got your Easter go to Sunday meeting clothes on, but just tell the truth this morning that all of us wrestle with that issue of sin. Can I help you this morning? Here's what Paul says in Romans. Paul says, when I desire to do good, I don't even have wrong on my mind. But Paul said, when I desire to do good, evil is ever present. Because I find myself wrestling with two individuals, and it don't look like y'all, it look like me. Paul says, I'm wrestling within my own self. Because I got two warriors on the inside. One that want to do right and the other one that want to do wrong. Paul says, oh wretched man that I am, who can deliver me from the body of this death? That's Bible. Paul said the answer is Jesus Christ. That's the only one that can deliver me from this torment that I'm going through. It's the only one that can deliver you. Can't break that cycle of sin by yourself. Just in case you are sacrilegious this morning, thinking you ain't never did nothing wrong, devil is a lie, and the truth is not in you. Because the Bible says again, for all have sinned. That includes you and me. All have sinned, come short of the glory of God. But God didn't leave us out there on the ledge by ourselves. He sent his only begotten Son, died for us. That's love. We're going to come now and extend an invitation of Christian discipleship. Would you stand with us this morning? There may be somebody here today who do not know Christ in the pardon of their sins. You have not accepted him. We offer Christ to you today. You may come with Christian experience, candidate for baptism or by letter. You're here this morning. Will you come? Tomorrow is not promised to any of us. Don't wait till tomorrow. Come today. Give your life to Christ today. While the blood is still yet running warm in your veins, give your life to Christ. That doesn't mean that you won't have problems, but now you have the problem solver in life. That doesn't mean you won't face challenges and situations. You still gonna face some challenges, but now you have a renewed hope because of what Christ did for us. Yes, he will. Yes, he will. Yes, he will. Come on, come on.
Christ to you, oh my brother, lead me off the Christ to you, oh.
thank God. Heaven rejoices. Amen. Ain't nobody mad today but the devil. He don't get no glory. Amen. 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 God is still adding to the church daily, such as should be so. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Death brought us together. Amen. Don't get ready now to receive our tithes and our offering. If you need a tithe and envelope, you would please raise your hand. One of our men ushers today will come help you with that. You can also give electronically with Givelify or Zelle. Or if you want to pay by credit card or debit card, you go to your right to classroom number 2, and someone from our finance ministry will receive you there. Give, the Bible says, and it shall be given unto you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, run it over, shall men give into your bosom. Malachi says, bring ye all the tithes into the storehouse, that there may be meat in mine house. And prove me now, it was said the Lord of hosts, if I will not open for you the windows of heaven, pour you out a blessing, that you shall not have room enough to receive. I don't doubt the power of tithing. I didn't get but a couple of people on that. I know what tithing will do. When you are tithing, is about obedience and faith. So obedience to what God has said, and then the faith to believe that God's going to do what he said. Amen. You cannot just pick out of the 66 books segments that you like and that you want to apply to certain things and then skip over the rest of it. That's not how the Bible works. You got to believe and receive and accept everything from Genesis to Revelation. And the one thing that we ought to take away today is that had Christ not given, there it is right there. Had he not given, we would not have salvation. But because he gave. Amen. Jesus, this is a good opportunity to teach a lesson. Because y'all was a little bit hesitant. Jesus observed what they were going and putting into the treasury. He also observed the actions of a widow who put in only 2 mites. And Jesus said, she has put in more than they all. Naturally, that doesn't make sense, because he said there were some other folk who gave, but they gave out of their abundance. That means they could afford to give and didn't hurt them. But here's this woman who only has about approximately less than the value of 2 pennies, which was all she had to her name, and she gave it to the Lord. What are you saying, Pastor? If you're going to believe God, you got to believe him also in the area of giving. God is not limited to what he can do. He can do more than just heal you. He can do more than just save you. He can and will take care of you. Amen. I may not have always had an abundance, but I never went to bed hungry. Come on in here this morning. Never had a day where I didn't have some clothes to put on my back, clean clothes. Never had a day where I didn't have a house or a roof over my head. Yeah. May have to pay it late sometime. Yeah. Come on, I'm just telling the truth this morning. But I still paid it. Yeah. Because when the river met the road, I said, Lord, I don't know where I'm going to get this light bill money from or where I'm going to get the rent money from. And God will make a way for me. And even in my seasons of tight, I never forgot to pay God first. It's rough sometimes. I'm going to stand here and tell you no lie and tell you that it's easy. Sometimes you're sitting there and you having to decide between whether or not I'm going to pay my tithe or pay it. And I say, I'm going to pay God because I believe he's going to take care of that. It's about faith. More of us in the church ought to bear witness of what God has done as a result of us being obedient as tithers. I'm not talking about folk who do like Ananias and Sapphira now. Y'all know that story. They lied about it. Don't lie about it. If you ain't tithing, just say, I don't tithe, I give. Amen, church. But if you don't tithe, don't lie about it now. I'm talking to somebody. You say, I give, but I'm not quite a tither yet. And if you're not at a 10% level, start somewhere. Start with 5% and give it consistently. And watch how God goes to work in your life. God will do it. God will do it. I'm done. I'm going to pray. Because y'all getting nervous now. I see you moving in your seat. Say, ooh, Lord, Pastor Business. Yeah, you picked a good day to come to church. Trying to help you grow in the kingdom. Father, we thank you today. We give you honor, glory, and praise. We thank you for these gifts that are about to be given. We ask your blessings upon them. Father, we saw through the lives of Cain and Abel how we're supposed to give. We're to give you the best of what we have, not the leftovers of what we have. For your word says in Proverbs, honor the Lord with thy substance and the first fruit of all thine increase. So shall your barns be filled with plenty and your vats will overflow with new wine. God, as we honor you through our giving today, we ask that you would grant the increase, Father. We know you will because you're not a man who should lie, neither the son of man that you should repent. But whatever you have said, you will make it true and make it good. We thank you today. Now bless these offerings, bless these gifts, some 30, some 60, some even 100-fold in return. This we ask and pray in Jesus' name. And it is amen, amen, and amen. Let us stand, come around, start with the overflow, bring our tithes and our offerings. Thank and praise God for all of you today. Not only to our members, but any guests that we have that came to worship with us today, we are grateful for your presence and your participation in this worship experience. May God continue to bless you and keep you. And we do extend this invitation to you to come again. Worship with us here at the Mount Nebo Missionary Baptist Church. Amen. God is our Father. The Son is our Savior and Redeemer, and the Holy Ghost is our Keeper and our Guide and Revealer. We thank God for all of you. We certainly say to you today, Happy Resurrection Sunday. Amen. Because the God that we serve is not dead, but he is alive. Amen. 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 He is the first fruits of them that slept. Amen. Let us rest on our feet as we get ready to adjourn. Father, we thank you today for what our eyes have seen, our ears have heard. Most of all, Master, we thank you for what our hearts have felt. We ask you now, God, to be with us as we leave this place, but never your presence. Keep us now, dear Master, we pray, that we may become the salt and light of this world, that we may influence and impact the world in a positive way for your glory and your kingdom. This we ask and pray in Jesus' name. And it is amen, amen, and amen. God bless you. Go in peace.